meeting to order. My name is Hannah Coyle, I'm the vice chair. I'd like to announce that this meeting is being recorded and videotaped. I'd like to ask all the members, I'd like to go around this way and have the members introduce themselves, please.
I'm Ruth McGrath, secretary.
Dave Ford, member.
Chris Palamas, member.
City Councilor Mary Ann Large.
Pat Chauncey, ADA coordinator and senior center director.
Would any members of the public like to introduce themselves?
I'm Judy Kimberly.
And are you affiliated with a certain...
I am, I have a background, I am going to apply to be on the commission, I have an extensive background in disability rights and laws.
Oh, okay.
And I am here also because I am married to Chris.
Oh, okay.
And you came of your own free will.
And I came of my own free will.
Welcome.
Would anybody like, oh, does anybody have any public comment? Would anybody like to make a motion to approve the June 16th?
Move to approve the minutes of June 16th.
I think it was June 17th, wasn't it? I don't have the paper in front of me.
June 16th.
Oh, it was June 16th.
Yeah.
Okay, June 16th, 2015.
So, second.
Thank you.
We need to have a discussion.
Okay.
Chris, second that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All in favor?
Hannah, we need to have discussion.
Discussion, okay.
There's a motion that was made and seconded, but there needs to be discussion.
Okay. Any
discussion on the minutes, because I have to know something. So on number three, City Councilor Mary Ann Large made a motion to approve the May 19th, 2015 minutes as amended, seconded by Ruth. The motion passed unanimously. You have to put in what the amendments were.
Oh, okay.
So I don't know if you can go back and...
Yeah.
And then we can add that for our September meeting, because we don't have a meeting in August.
I think that was an amendment, wasn't it, that Tori made?
Yeah. And what was it?
I don't have it here right now.
I don't either.
So when somebody's looking at the minutes from May 19th, they're going to see them as written without, and if they went to then June, they would see what was changed or what the issue was in May. It could have been a spelling correction, it could have been a name change, it could have been almost anything. So the amendment should be listed when the votes are taken. And if there are none, obviously there's no amendments.
But usually, Patty, if it's a typo, we say typo on it.
Okay.
But you do have the recording of the last meeting, so you should be able to know where that amendment was through Tori. And I cannot recall. I know you were writing something down.
I just go back to
when she was making that amendment.
Yeah, I do have notes that I took. I don't have them with me when I was reviewing these. So that's all that my comment is that it should list the amendments.
Yeah.
Or amendment if there was only one.
Thank you. That's a very good idea. That would be appreciated.
Mm-hmm. But thank you, Ruth, for doing the minutes. It's much appreciated, as I was saying.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. It was nice of Tori as well to add any changes to the minutes and to add any amendments.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. All in favor of accepting the minutes as written?
As written?
The minutes, Yes, that's what I believe is usually said.
But she said as long as we include that amendment. That's what we're going to have to do. We're going to approve it by having Ruth add that amendment.
Okay, so first, okay.
Yeah.
All right, so who would like to make, approve that we, who would like to approve that we accept?
Just to make a motion?
Just make a motion to amend the amendments with question number three to add on what the amendment was.
Okay.
There you go.
Who would like to make a motion?
I'll make the motion.
Okay, thank you.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
This is the first time I've attended a Robert's Rules meeting in years.
I'll give you the book, I got it.
It sounds familiar.
Let's see, so, well, we have a guest here today, Lisa Downey from the Forbes Library. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for inviting me.
You're welcome.
So Lisa's the Assistant Director at Forbes Library, and you have other titles as well.
Yeah, and patron services librarian. Should I begin? Thank you so much for inviting me here today. I was looking back, and I had attended your meeting in the fall, I believe it was in November, with Janet Molding, our director, and Ben Kalish from our information services staff to announce the two-year grant that we've received to improve services for patrons with disabilities. We're now winding up the first year of that, and I would like to give some updates on where things stand. I think one of the things that was on people's mind last time and is probably still on people's mind this time is about the elevator, and so I'll begin with an update on the elevator. The elevator is being, we believed it would happen last week, and we're now being told it's going to happen this week, that the custom-built elevator that was constructed off-site should be delivered this week, and then it's going to be a 25 working day process to install the elevator. So that still puts us at the end of August, which is, you know, what they had originally told us, and then we were hoping that it might be sooner than that. All the site work has been done, and the metal frame for the elevator has been installed and painted. So the elevator will go in, and then there is decorative work that will go on the outside, and I'm sure many other steps, but we're hoping to have this elevator open at the end of August.
That'll be super.
Yes. Yeah. That will be, and it's been a long time coming, and you know, we've really regretted the time that it's taken, where we have had no access, but we hope that this elevator, we expect that this elevator will be fully functioning and serve our needs of the community for years to come. So I guess that's the good news. The upper doors, which are, they're two very heavy glass doors, which are also an accessibility issue in that they're very hard to push open, and they were designed with very thick and attractive glass, but they never were hung right, and so those are being replaced. That won't happen until October, we've been told. So, but luckily, they said the disruption will be minimum, and we will keep things operating. The elevator will be up and running during that time, including the automatic door at the top of the elevator, so it won't affect the elevator operation, so we'll still have access even with that.
So what kind of doors are they?
They're going to be more similar to the ones on the front, so there's still a lot of glass, because it is nice to let the light in, but there will be a metal frame, and there'll be the closure will be more traditional, so it should open and close much smoother, and you know, you sort of get used to doors that you can just push and they open instead of having to push to make them, you know, with physical force, so they'll hopefully be the latter, that they'll be nice and easy to open and still attractive and keeping with the building. Are there any questions about the elevator?
Yes, Lisa.
Yes.
Because we have a new member on the commission, and after I'm going to have him talk, which would be the right way to go, about who Chris is, what he can do, and so forth like that. I don't think, Chris, you knew what... what had happened at Forbes Library. There was a huge fundraiser that I had some friends that were highly involved in that fundraiser for the elevator, and they raised the money. Then they went back to the, what was it, three? You had three firms, right?
Yes.
Who gave the bids.
Yes, that came in way too high.
And it came up way high. So.
As a custom elevator?
Yes. The footprint of the space is very constricted. Yes. So, yes.
That kind of like held us back because all of them, city councilors, the mayor, everybody were going, oh boy, here we go, you know. But it worked.
Yes. Yeah, we'll feel even better when it's actually doing its job, but it is very close.
Is the cab size less than the fully compliant? Because if so, got to deal with a waiver to the access board.
It has been, and I have to apologize that I haven't been as actively involved in that process as I have been in the grant that I'll talk about, but it has, it's received approval. I believe that it is a smaller footprint, but still within keeping with guidelines that one of the changes that were made is that the doors are going to, you come in on the bottom right and exit on the upper left, so you can more of a diagonal to have a little bit more of the diagonal space will be a little bit better.
But it's not a new shaft. It is a new shaft.
Yes.
So if the space is not compliant with the full size elevator requirement, then a waiver is required for the access board. And it's better to deal with that sooner rather than later.
Okay.
And sometimes that can be done in simple terms, giving the entire history and asking for an advisory opinion from the director of the access board. With the support of the commission and of the local center for independent living.
Somebody might want to call Louis Hasbrook, the building commissioner, and have him look at it. He also is on the architectural access board.
He's on the what?
He is on the architectural access board.
In Boston?
Yeah. He came to one of our meetings, couldn't tell you which one, not too long ago, to let us know that he he was asked to be on that.
He's a building inspector. Yeah. Just gave him a call.
So I'm assuming that he was put on the board.
I hope so.
Yeah.
And that's twice a month traveling to Boston. That's a huge commitment.
I will bring that back. Thank you very much. Any other questions about the elevator?
Just looking forward to it.
Can you give Louis a call? And could you get back to us on the reply back? Because I'm also going to talk to him about that.
Okay. To Patty, can I get back?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, this may be something that they've already handled and that I'm just ignorant of that fact, but I will follow up and get back to Patty about the concern.
Because I don't know when he goes to Boston. What is it? Twice a month, you said?
Yeah, I don't know. It may be just once a month, first two. I'm not sure of the schedule, but it's a big commitment. So.
I also wanted to talk a little bit about the progress on our grant that we've received. Since seeing you last, we have had two staff trainings as we identified staff training needs. And the first training was a panel discussion where staff were able to hear firsthand stories of community members living with different disabilities and also the importance and impact of the library. Library access challenges, so that was very good for everyone to hear directly. And then the second was an experiential training where we had staff navigate the library in wheelchairs with blindfolds, filling out forms with limited mobility, dexterity, limiting gloves on, different forms of eye impairment, glasses, wearing headphones. And so it was very interesting to experience our library, and even like the small threshold on the bathroom door, which is, was very eye-opening for us and for me in particular, trying to get in and get out with that small threshold. And we have big ideas about things that we would like to change in the future, but we also have tasked each of the departments to look around them and to sort of working procedures or collection services, pamphlets, the way information is presented, that they can make changes within their working groups. So we'll be following up on that in August. So both big and small feedback, and the training was very important, and it's ongoing. We have made major AV audiovisual improvements to our two of our meeting spaces. We installed a new projector and sound system in our community room that now has, instead of just two speakers in the front, there front and midway. We also, that room is now equipped with a transmitter for an FM assistive listening system that we will offer at public programs. And also the projector itself is up to date with high definition standards, but it's also a bigger and a brighter picture, so that will be an enhancement. People are already coming, it's been, that's been in place for about 6 weeks or so. People are,
that's a great,
yes. The other space, the Coolidge Museum, which we do some of our programming in, has actually just has a projector installed for the first time, and speakers, they're just two in the front, but they provide very good sound in the space. So again, the sound quality will be a lot better, and that also has the transmitter for the FM system. That FM system also came with a tour guide system, so that we can have that in our two of our other smaller meeting rooms for conversations between a small group of people. We can also use it when we do provide library tours or other types of community events that aren't taking place in the two spaces. So we're very excited about that. We took on a relabeling project for our DVD collection to make it easier for our staff and the public that are able to identify closed caption and describe videos, as well as several other categories of videos. We have
doing closed caption.
The videos often, it says in very, very, very small type generally on the DVD that it has closed captioning. But some of our labeling was covering up that labeling, and also it was just very hard to see. So we've created spine labels that very clearly we can browse and pull items for people, or if they're able to browse themselves, they'll be able to, we'll have a key, because it's a little bit complex. Those are two of the categories, but there's several different types of video modified adaptations, I guess you would say. So
that's a big movement, because as a city councilor, I have many people in the city of Northampton on my board, many friends who are hard of hearing and have actually expressed to Comcast and to NCTV of the use of Comcast of every city meeting. And it's the cost that's stopping it all. And it shouldn't be. I think there should be a law, because I find it to be a civil rights issue, I find it to be a human rights issue, that people cannot hear, okay, because of the closed caption not being available. So hopefully someday with more healing, we can get this push to make it mandatory that no matter where throughout the state of Massachusetts, every meeting should be closed captioned. That's a big problem. I mean, people watch it on TV, you don't know what they're saying.
I've heard recently Comcast, I believe now it has a fully annotated TV guide. Is that true? Is that
They don't have closed caption. I just had him on my committee.
Yeah, now you can talk. You don't even have to type anymore. You just talk into your remote. They've done a lot.
Yeah, you know what they're doing in CTV? At one point, we used to have several volunteers coming in with the cameras. Mm. Eventually, they're doing away with the volunteers. It's all going to be automatic to turn the switch on.
So
nobody there
with the cameras?
Sometimes you only have one person.
Yeah.
So there's your state of the art of technology.
Yes, well, I know we the library does produce some videos, and they're not, and we have now made it a standard that we caption all of the videos that we produce. And even, now we'll talk a little bit more about programming. When we show a lot of movies publicly, and we're going to be offering and publicizing more, you know, turning on captions, as well as describe. We're hoping to do a special describe video event, and just be more aware of who's in the audience and if they're able to enjoy the movie that we're showing. So it's, and I understand about the city council meetings. I've heard that too.
That's every meeting. Planning board, zoning, transportation and parking, every city meeting. You know, like the senior center with the board of trustees meetings and that. People have the rights to know what is being said. And to me, I don't know why it's such a big deal that they can't put something on the bottom when somebody's talking. So that's why I think it's a big issue, and I take it seriously, because I am partially deaf, and I will fight as hard as I can to make it happen, to give everybody a good quality of life. And people are just sitting back at it, and I don't think it's fair.
So Lisa, who's doing the captioning on your video?
So our videos that we're typed are very short, so we're able to handle that in-house. One option that was told that was we were going to explore is remote cart, which is the
yes.
So that seems like an affordable solution to pursue for other types of event programming that we want that have more dialogue or longer content.
I would say that's interesting and important. The availability of remote cart and what the hourly cost is going to be for general meeting use. That hourly will be significant, and the longer range solution is going to be technological when the automated transcriptions become dependable enough.
And there's two programs now that work great to caption things. There, you put them on your home computers now and just run it through and it'll come out captioned, but they're very expensive. You know, I talked with NCTV about volunteering for them, but they must spend money on the software.
What is the cost? What's an average?
I don't even remember. It's over $500. I know just has one package. So that's why I didn't buy
it. You could find out,
okay? Yeah, I can get you the names and the prices.
Just for information, in Boston, at Channel 2, WGBH, there is the National Center for Accessible Media. And they have been the leaders in the development of transcription for movie theaters and some of the others. So I think one of the paths we would see forward is would be some kind of a beginning of a state process to demonstrate, and probably using evaluation of technology through a place like the National Center for Accessible Media, and then to start to distribute it. How long will it take us to get there?
A while.
Okay,
I know.
Yes.
Thank you for the other.
But I have to say.
But this is very good.
It
I have
is.
To say, this is
it
what
is.
You're doing is.
Lisa and the city are working tirelessly to make huge improvements. And I commend you for that. And all the city employees working hard, all the fundraising, to give everybody a good quality of life. And to me, that's valuable. That's taking a lot of money, but we're doing it.
Can I ask who provided your training, the staff training?
Yeah, the first training, we have a grant consultant from the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners who has been administering this grant, and she teaches at Simmons College, the library science program. Her name is Shelley Cazada, and she was the person who really said this is important, because a lot of people just don't have experience, and there's a lot of fear or just unfamiliarity with working with people with disabilities, and so we wanted to sort of demystify that. And so she said, I put this together with Mary Jo Stanley, who is a local person who has experienced sudden adult onset hearing loss, There was Robert Barron, who may be familiar to some of you. He is the he's a technology assistant instructor at HCC and lives in Chinatown and worked with their library, and he is blind. And we had, we had Carol Rossick from the Massachusetts Commission of the Deaf and Hard of Hearing, who has since retired, and we have been in touch with her counterpart in Boston, who seems great to work with. And we had somebody, and I'm so sorry, that works with children with disability issues for they're an advocacy group, a parent advocacy group for children with disabilities, and I can track that down. The second tranche.
Is that person local?
She was actually out of the Wilbraham area. She had come into, they had held one of their board meetings or their group meetings at a library, and I said, oh, I'd like to talk to you. And she has a daughter with severe physical mobility issues as well as some cognitive challenges, and so I'm talking to her, her daughter's an avid reader, so that was really eye-opening for people.
I bet you it must have been the same woman I met for Whole Children.
Yes, Whole Children, that's the organization, thank you.
Was that Isa DeLodge at that time with her when you met her?
Perhaps.
She's moved on now. Gone to another.
Okay. And then for the second training, we worked with a woman named Mira Parker O'Toole, who is at Wheelock College, and she has some physical impairments herself, but she also runs a center for assistive and innovative technology, and she was just fantastic. And she put together, she worked with some of her students and colleagues to put the experiential training, and then led us through an exercise called design thinking, which is really fun. It was a way to sort of tease out of us sort of what we do about disability issues at the library, and sort of what the sort of based on strengths, weaknesses, sort of one of those types of exercises. But it was done in a really interesting way, and sort of we came out with some concrete solutions, which is what we were hoping for.
I think it sounds really, really thorough, and it's good to have the names on the record of who you rely
yes.
on, because to have specialized training that addresses libraries is a real plus.
Thank you. We have also, since I think these are the next couple of things I talked about at the meeting in the fall, but they've now actually happened. We've installed what they call countertop loop systems on all of our service desks. And these are devices that we can work with patrons, and we have terrible acoustics at most of our service desks, so it will allow us to have our patron either wear a headset or with a T-coil enabled hearing aid. Our staff will talk into a microphone and the sound will be much, not only louder, but much clearer. And that's one of the things in the long distance process that I've learned, that it's not so much a volume issue, but a clarity issue with a lot of hearing loss, so it's a much clearer sound. They are available. The JAWS screen reading software, magnification software packages are now on our public computers. We have illuminated magnifying glasses for patrons at all of our service desks, and we've now implemented whiteboards to aid communication when we can have verbal communication.
Oh, that's great.
And these, all of these things, we're looking at September as our launch date, or really hoping that the elevator's in place, that we start looking as a point where we can really advertise many of these things and sort of be a celebration of the elevator being completed, but also really get the word out, because what I've heard time and time again is that people, both on the staff and in the public, aren't aware that we have these and won't be adopted, and they'll just collect dust, and that's
when
really not.
Looking at that?
We have, yeah, well, I hate to even set a date until I'm sure the elevator will be in, because then that would be devastating. I'd probably be later in September, but I have not set a date yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
I really would like to give you a request, and I think it would be great if
yes.
you did this,
yes.
to come to City Council
okay.
and do a presentation
okay.
on an update of the elevator process. And everything that you also are talking about here at this meeting, to all city councilors and to the residents of the city of Northampton. It is televised, it's on NCTV, and I think that would be great to have you come in. I just had and Social Services, Veterans Cultural Recreation. We have, again, the Academy of Music. Because you're looking at CPA money, you're looking at taxpayers' money, and I like to keep the visibility there of letting everybody see what has happened. We're gone from A, the video was fantastic, showing the process of the Academy of Music from beginning to end, and how deplorable that the inside was until people actually see that video. I mean, the flooring was so bad up on the top, you could actually go through it. So I, if you could possibly really think about this, get a hold of me, and I will get you on City Council to come in and do a presentation.
Fantastic.
And can I have your email also, if you could add it on here for me?
Yes.
Because I think it would be great to do that.
Thank you, Mary Ann.
Thank you. I'm sorry to take up so much time. Two more quick things that I'd like to...
Very worthwhile.
Please continue.
Okay.
Please do. Thank you.
Quickly, we have established an institutional membership with the Perkins Braille and Talking Book Library, and now have a Daisy Reader to demonstrate. That's the digital audio book players, and we have a small collection to loan. And we're really hoping that this will be a tool that people have, either for themselves or a family or friend that are thinking about that they're not able to read the way that they did there. With vision loss, or even not able to hold materials, that this will sort of give them, that they can take it, they can try it without signing up, even though the sign-up process is very simple. Mm-hmm. We just wanted to make that more available. And we have had a Braille collection in our children's department, but we're trying to it goes out a lot through interlibrary loan, but we're new signage and also making sure we include that in our new literature. And I don't know, I might have glossed over that we're talking about, we were almost done with new large print, high contrast welcome brochures, hours information cards, and library card applications that I hope to have to show you today, but I will have those in the near future. We also developed an advisory board specifically for library suggestions, and Patty actually was very kind to let us meet here because it's not possible to be at the library at this point, but we received some really great suggestions and feedback. And one of the things that we talked about was programming, and the second year really being a very public year where we're announcing what we have, but also inviting people into the public programming that we're hoping to have it as accessible as possible. And I have some really great suggestions, both, you're welcome, for programming that include, I'll just talk about them very quickly, but we're talking about some book discussion series, an assistive technology series, a film series, and then a handful of things that aren't really fitting into series, but historical programs, one about Grace Coolidge and her work with the Clark School, another about reading lists for parents with for children with disabilities. And just some really interesting suggestions for user groups for our community, that just offering a space and support for people to come together who are experiencing similar situations. So Mary Jo Stanley was there, and she's now working with other adults with adult onset hearing loss, and so the library can play a role in just an encouraging community gathering, which is one of our modern library objectives these days. We're hoping to work on signage in the second year, and we have lots of other plans. So the grant project is very exciting for me, yes.
Lisa, there was something new going on at the library now where you're doing movies on the outside?
Yes.
You had Jaws going the first night? Mm-hmm. How was that?
they were incredibly popular. I think we had 300 and over 300 at one, and over 400 at the other.
Where did you hold these?
On our west lawn, which is, if you're familiar with the library, the incoming driveway, that lawn. It sloped actually very nicely for outdoor because it just kind of gently goes down. and people love it. We're partnering with Cinema Northampton, which includes NCTV, the Rec Department, and a couple of other agencies. And it's been really, really fun. People have enjoyed it.
Did they bring their coolers and all that?
Yeah, people are encouraged. At the library, we partnered with Bistro Le Gras and the pizza shop, Pizza Amore, and that mobile bicycle-powered little pastry shop, and they came and set up food, which people enjoyed, but you could also just bring your own.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
When's the next one scheduled?
Well, actually, there's one a week from tomorrow at Mansfield in that series. It's going to be Goonies. And then we'll be back at Forbes in August, late August, with, oh my gosh, what was the movie that we're showing? Another sort of one in that era. Oh boy. I cannot think of it all right now, but we are doing one more in that series.
Yeah. What if it rains?
We do a rain date generally the following Wednesday, and then if it gets postponed and it still rains the second date, then we'll move inside. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's great.
I have one last update, and this I wish was better news, but it's something I felt important to talk to you about, and that is our outreach program.
Your outreach?
Outreach program. Yeah, our outreach program is a service that we've had for years and years. It used to be much larger than it is now, and now it's for the past few years, it's been running with one part-time staff person, and it's a delivery service for homebound people in homes and in assisted living situations in the community, and he selects materials based on their reading interests. He'll also deliver movies, and he delivers them once every 2 or 3 weeks, and then goes back and picks them up. And this is for people with temporary disabilities, if you aren't able to get in, or long-term. He has long-term patrons, and he serves about 100 people a year. That's not all at once, because there is some loss, unfortunately, in his clientele, people passing on.
Is this also involved with Linda Maynard and all these places?
Yes. Yes.
Have you talked with the mayor about the outreaching of finding some of students at the colleges? We use volunteers. We use volunteers actually from University of Madison Smith College. Consultant work right down the line. So you should talk to the mayor about that. He might be able to get you some help.
Okay. You mean, it's Patty, there was an announcement last summer, though. A year ago, the program was cut in half with city funding, and we found a donor for the other half of the funding. And then you found Robin, who's been a fantastic volunteer, who's been working with we have one staff person. His name is Frank Heston. He's fantastic. He's well-liked, and he enjoys spending the time with the people.
How did you get him?
I didn't get Frank. Frank's been with that program for many, many years, and when the program was going to be eliminated because of funding and also because of the vehicle that was kind of run into the ground. Maybe that wasn't a fair statement to say about the vehicle, but anyway, transportation and getting the materials to and from homes. But we did a lot of outreach to get volunteers for their program. And, you know, we were just letting people know that the program was in jeopardy based on funding and the need for volunteers.
Right, and we have the Youth Commission in the city. They're very active. They just did all the artwork on the benches in Northampton and that. They're very active, active committee.
So what's the
So that the second year, the donor said that he would. It was an anonymous donor who had the program cost $16,000 a year. That's the staff member's salary. He uses his own vehicle at this point, and our friends support his mileage costs, which are not significant. They used to support the car. Now he's just being reimbursed for his mileage. The library provides the materials, so we continue to do that as part of our book budget, but his salary is $16,000. So it went down to $8,000 with city funds, and in this year's budget that was not provided. So the donor said that he would consider funding it if the city was matching the other half, but since the city wasn't matching the other half, he's not as interested. It's still at this point, actually our trustees are talking about this next week. Our friends group has expressed interest in trying to trying to help, but it's very much in jeopardy, and it's very troubling to me.
But the city is saying that they won't step in to pay. They have their reasons.
You know, this, when we talked to the city in our budget process that we were, you know, said we should find another donor. And the volunteer labor, I just will talk a little bit about that. We are very open to volunteers, although there are some functions in this project that are beyond the scope of a volunteer. And I think, you know, if Robin can test, I talked to her about this, and she's a wonderful volunteer, but she's actually just supporting Frank in finding the material, in pulling the materials. But if you're developing a relationship, these people are relying on you. A lot of times Frank's going into situations where people have decreasing mental capacity, physical capacity, and sometimes, you know, people passing away, you know, not right when he's there. But I mean, it's pretty substantial work. There's also interfacing with our circulation software, patron privacy issues. It's just, the only way I could see it working is if there was somebody coordinating it. And we sort of, you know, looked at that, but we have 75 active volunteers at any time, and I'm the volunteer coordinator, and I believe 100% volunteers. But in looking at this program, it's beyond the scope of a volunteer. It's really paid work. There's a level of professionalism and commitment and skill that takes an employee, and that's to oversee it at the very least.
I wonder, Lisa, if through the senior tax work-off program, I mean, because there's some incredible experience and knowledge, that there could be someone in. I don't know what the number of hours will be for next year. It's probably still 111. Mm-hmm. But, you know, one person could start, and then another person can move in once those hours are done.
And we've been very blessed with the senior tax work-off employees.
That's some good people.
Yes. That is definitely something to explore.
You should just go make an appointment and go in and see the mayor. Because you're stressing how you feel of the dire need of that. And talk to him about the work program, the senior work program. Because I do have residents who have come down here at the senior center and work, and all of a sudden they put in all their hours and then they're not here. Okay? And the mayor keeps going to keep adding on, hopefully, to what we have right now. So you really should, Lisa, go in and see him.
Okay. All right.
Appreciate that. He might be able to guide you and help you out.
And the thing, too, about, because we, a number of staff here do home visits for outreach, that it isn't like in this case with Frank dropping a book off, like, here's the book that you asked. There's conversation there. It's not like quick in and quick out. There's other discussions and contact and reassurance and all of that that take place.
Mm-hmm. What's her name? Eleanor?
Uh-huh. I don't know.
She's so happy about that. They have a library of books.
Yep.
Lisa, you mentioned the next movie date is at the end of August. Do you usually hold the movies on Wednesdays or Fridays?
The movies are generally on Wednesday evening. The library's open Monday and Wednesday evening, and I noticed that even the one at Midsummer is going to be on a Wednesday night. I think maybe just to keep things consistent for us. So ours is at the end of August.
I want to note that it's becoming uncomfortably hot in this room.
That's awful.
And I certainly can't stay very long in this
room. No, it's really bad.
Okay, I'll just say that the request to have AC on was to be on delay of black. And I'm sorry that it's an issue. I guess if people have to leave, then that's what's going to have to happen. There's nothing I can do right now because I have to call someone. It's electronically done, so.
I know, because when I got here,
no control.
It was hotter than happened here.
Yeah, and I apologize. I did request air conditioning for this evening.
Well, I would like to let us go ahead and move so we can start talking about some of the important issues also that we have on this agenda, so we can get right out of here.
Marianne, First, I'd like to thank Lisa so much.
Yes.
For coming. Thank you so much for discussing all of the new advances and the projects and the improvements and the effort that everyone is doing at the library and will be continuing to do. So thank you so much.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you.
And invite us to the grand opening when the elevator is ready to go.
Yeah.
Thank you. Let's see. I'd also like to mention that I know Tori and Ruth were present at the acceptance of the proclamation commemorating the 25th anniversary of the ADA. And I'd like to thank both Tori and Ruth for being present at the meeting, the July 9th meeting. And there's a really nice photo on the disability website of the acceptance of the proclamation by Tori and Ruth from the mayor. So thank you very much.
I'm just gonna add that Jim Winston was there also.
Mm-hmm. Since Mr. Winston, Jim isn't here today, we will table the discussion of the new sick time law in Massachusetts for September, if he's ready at that time.
Yep, if Tori wants to put that on the agenda, mm-hmm. He's willing to do that in September.
Okay. Next on the agenda is ideas for Disability Commission pamphlet presented by Ruth McGrath.
Okay, this is going to be really quick. While this is being passed around, I have talked to Trey. I have two really quick just information things. This is a whole booklet about the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. It ensures students with disability provided with free appropriate public education that is tailored to their individual needs. It's just for information. I have it. There was an article in the newspaper which brought it to my attention, which is fastened here. I can pass it around if anybody wants to read it. If not, we'll just put it right in the library.
All right. I'd be happy to read it, Ruth. Thank you.
The other thing I wanted to ask about is, what do we do with the proclamation? Do we frame it and hang it?
It's going to be put on the Disability Commission bulletin board here.
Oh, okay. Do you need to frame it? I have some frames. I don't know.
What is?
If you want to frame it, and then otherwise I usually put stuff on a heavy, but if you have a frame, I'd be happy to put it in a frame.
Okay. There was an old brochure, which I didn't bring a copy of the old one with me. I'm sorry, my computer quit today and it's on there.
Okay, but where did you find them?
I took the old one and just tried to revamp it in my head. I went out to our website and took, most of this is all from our website. That's on here, and some things are duplicated. There are holes where I need information. I need everybody to take this draft, and this is just a draft.
Did you go to Patty to look at that draft before you brought it to the meeting?
No, I figured I'd just bring it to the meeting and let everybody look at it.
So I think if everybody writes draft on it on the front, and then I think what Ruth's asking is everybody to look at it and make additional.
Yeah, because I don't know anything about it. It says, please contact the ADA coordinator for information on local resources, for example, transportation, housing.
Comes right off our website. It's right off the Northampton MA website. All of this is. But there's things that, like the wheelchair is duplicated because I needed a space holder just to keep it in place.
Well, I'm going to need time to look over.
Well, that's why I thought I'd just give them to everybody, sure. Take them home.
Yes, thank you.
And then maybe in September I can collect and put together, and then we'll have another draft we can look at.
Yeah, and since Chris is on too, and possibly maybe his wife might get on.
Right.
Get some more stuff in here.
Yeah, so that was just, we talked about advertising, and this is a good way to get our word out there. Another question I want you to think about, I pulled a couple of similar brochures from other cities. They have their members' names on them. So I put our names on here, but there's two things you gotta think about. I put your name out in public, and if we print these, and then we lose a member or change a member, it would be out of date.
Mine's up on the website for the city anyways. Basically, they have to do that for all councilors and...
Everybody here is...
It's on the website, that's where I got it from.
Everybody is a public entity sitting here. So my concern would be printing a bunch of these, and then the names change. But I suppose that happens no matter what. You know, people do stationery and members leave, and they don't have all the stationery.
If we don't put the names, I did put a link to the website on here.
So all comments we get to you, Ruth, right?
Yep, and then I'll put them together and bring us back another draft.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Thanks for joining.
What's next?
That's it for me, I'm done.
Okay, the new banner for Disability Commission. Where is our banner now, Patty?
It's in the hallway.
You got it in the hall?
Yeah.
It's displayed?
No, it's just rolled up in the hallway.
Because Ruth, you had brought up to me a couple of times about the banner should be displayed, correct?
You brought it up in the meeting.
Yeah, so we moved the disability bulletin board closer to the library, thinking that that banner could get put up above the library door, so to keep it together. So as soon as I can get somebody to do that, that's where it's gonna go. So if you look at the library, there's windows, and then right above there, there's an open space.
That's perfect.
That can go.
Except, is that banner on the date now? Did our name change?
It says Commission on Disability, but...
Oh, good.
I think it can still be...
Disability Commission.
Yeah.
Yeah, whatever.
I think it's fine to still have it.
Now, what I'd like to do, Patty, if there was any way possible that we could order another banner, but a little bit bigger, for the use of parades.
Right, did you find out the size that...
Not that time.
Okay. So do you want me to wait to find out?
No.
Get it, just figure out a bigger size?
Yeah, stuff and figure probably what we use for parades. What's the size do we use for parades? We're trying to do that. I would say from here to here.
About 5 feet?
Bigger than what you have. You have, what, a 3-footer right now?
I have to measure it here, and I haven't...
So I would say...
Is that table 6 feet?
Not the pole, the banner from here to about here. Because you have two people, hold, well, maybe you better go a little bit.
Yeah, I don't know, I'd say 6 feet.
Yeah.
I'd say 6 feet.
Goes down.
Which would be, you know, as if it's that whole size and that table.
Yes. Because you put the poles through and you have a person holding it.
Yeah.
We're trying to initiate Chris starting to do parades.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have it around here at all.
Publicity is one big thing.
So is there a possibility, Patty, that you could do that?
Yeah.
Okay, discussion on a roundtable with other commissions and ADA coordinators for the month of October. We did this a year ago?
Yeah, I think last October it was that we did.
And I just told Chris today what I was thinking about again, opening the doors, getting transparency, getting total communication out there with other ADA corners throughout Springfield, Amherst, all the hill towns, Amherst, East Hampton, wherever. I just think it's very idle that we start doing this. I know, Ruth, you had concerns also of transparency, and I'm hearing it. And I feel it's very valuable and it needs to be done.
Well, last year, having invited all these different ADA coordinators and the different committee members throughout the Western Mass, actually, we invited a lot of people. There were a lot of great ideas that came from everybody, what they were doing in their own community. So
exactly.
They also had
concerns too, Patty. They talked that it was great about the parades. And I told them, I said, we'd get them back so we could talk about what problems are actually having, people are having with disabilities, disabilities that are visible and some that are not, okay? Sidewalks, big problem here in the city of Northampton. And there's no question about it, and I think we need to be more aggressive with this. Money is the issue, but people do have the rights of a good quality of life, and sidewalks need to be taken care of. We have more and more people on wheelchairs now, walking in crutches all over the place on Florence Road, and that's another one, Patty. Is there such a thing of signage? I know I looked into this with you a couple of years ago of a person with a wheelchair that was accessing, remember, through Florence Road? Whatever happened to that?
I'll just say I had a conversation with Ned because they make signs, and that was kind of the end of it.
He said there was no signs?
No. I had a conversation with Ned about signs for there and also different signs for down here. That was kind of the end of it. There was no more. No, and I'm not saying Ned didn't get back to me. I'm just saying that's sort of where the conversation went, and neither of us pursued it in another meeting.
Why?
It just didn't happen.
Well, I would like to make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I think the signage is extremely important, Patty. You're looking at a rural area with no sidewalks,
mm-hmm.
and people have no way of accessing a street without going on the main street because of no sidewalks. Mm-hmm. And I just saw it again with somebody in a wheelchair on Florence Road. I don't know where they came from, but there it was.
It happens a lot downtown too, that people in wheelchairs are moving on scooters.
Back up a little bit on the general idea of a meeting, which I think is tremendously useful. But we have a couple of points of departure here.
Yeah.
And one is that tomorrow in Boston, the Attorney General will make her, I think she's going to be the introductory speaker at any point. She's going to be a key speaker at the 25th anniversary celebration on Boston Common. She will announce the formation of a disability advisory committee. Some of the names will be recognizable. We push for significant Western Mass participation. And it just happens, our line to Maura was, disability reform in Massachusetts began in Western Mass and it's been best realized. So one of the things that we would like to put on our agenda will be specifically reaching out to municipalities in terms of, given that this is the 25th year, we still don't know what the status is of self-evaluations and transition plans, which are required, but the, you know, beyond the formal legal requirement, you know, a plan is the practical way to bring all of the issues together, establish some priorities, get, you know, not just collect the information, but really present it, you know, within the structure of any municipality move forward. So we would certainly like to, at some point, have the Attorney General probably coming here to Western. We could try to do that potentially around a meeting like this of coordinators. And commissions, I think, would be really appropriate.
And you're talking about with Maura Haley coming in?
Yes, with Maura.
And I think I had told you today, and I talked with Patty about this, about using the great room here at the Senior Center. So, Patty, that would be available for us, correct? We would not have to pay that for that room because this is a commission.
If it was in off hours, meaning that the Senior Center's closed, we'd have to pay for the building monitor, which is usually 10-15 hours. But if it's when the building's open, then there would be, you know, staff here.
We're going to have to go by Maura Haley's schedule.
Right, yeah, you had mentioned
okay.
that before. Yeah.
Now,
we'll simply, we will propose this to her. We
can't
commit her time, but I think it would be good if this is going to be a general effort of the Attorney General's office to try to have a kickoff and demonstration, you know, out here in,
I think it'd be great.
In her home, in a territory that I think she feels a real kinship with.
So Patty, what if we, she's going to be doing this on Wednesday, where she'll be announcing, correct? That's what you're saying, of her new...
She's announcing the formation of the Disability Advisory Committee.
Now, you have access to her office, correct?
Yes.
Chris is going to be on...
You're going to be on?
Are we saying any name?
Oh, no.
Who's going to be on that commission, because decisions can always...
To go to Boston, I wish I was.
There will be a few names that would be recognizable in this community.
Okay. Which would be great if you could talk to Maura for us and get a month, because we're going to need to know this, that we could get her in here.
Can discuss a target for October or November. My feeling on these processes is time is always a wasting. You know, we had the election last November. We'd be coming up to a full year. If we're going to, you know, basically move action, then we need to do it as quickly as possible. This is not difficult to organize. The basic body of information is well known. It would be a matter of getting invitations out in a timely way, and if we can get, we certainly can get representation from the Attorney General's office. We would like to, of course, get the Attorney General.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what we're saying is, because we're going to do the roundtable in October, to not think about doing that, think about possibly getting more Healy to come in, possibly, and having an open session with all ADA coordinators and all of our invites.
Well, can I say, what makes sense to you all? You've been working at this level.
Well, it's what we're trying to accomplish with each of those items, and is there anything that's sort of overlapping? So what is it we would want to accomplish at a round table versus what is it we're trying to accomplish with Maura Healy?
I think we want to accomplish a lot with her.
You know, is there an overlap?
I think the overlap is very simple. The foundation of the municipality's responsibility is ADA compliance, articulated in a self-evaluation and transition plan, most of which are incomplete and sparse and probably need to be updated. The other, which I think is really significant, is how do you create this network of communication and support? And at some level, in terms of supporting local coordinators, you know, there's a line where it becomes very ambiguous. Where is the municipal responsibility? Where does it become state responsibility? As we're talking about this expansion of effective communication principles in the public meeting law, for example, if that's going to be done, that's going to really require state leadership. Because if each municipality tries to grasp new technology and apply it, and then, you know, one community is bearing a very complicated technical task, and that you're bearing costs, which are much better to figure out how it would be done and then provide something that is reasonably well developed to be adopted at the municipal level. That's my sense of how to do it. We're working on ADA compliance through the state, for example, with higher education, and it's some very similar issues when you work within a particular campus and they say, we really need to broker some of these resources. We can't simply contain them within one campus, particularly when we come to things like computer-assisted real-time, the shortage of interpreters in the classes.
So so what do you
think? So what I think is the sort of the key and most important thing would be that it would be Lori Healy coming here. All the ADA commission members are invited here, and you know, we have 300 or so people, and we're getting the message about what this new advisory is going to be doing. And then at a later date, you know, if we did something in, I don't want to say February, March, because people have an issue about winter type meetings, but that could be sort of the round table that we discuss issues and problems and situations, some of which would be brought up with Speaker Maura Healy's here.
So Maura Healy's going to come, and we're going to let her talk, and whoever's on this new advisory board of what their duties are. But to me, that's not going to take a long time to do that. I think when you have AD coordinators throughout the state of Massachusetts who are invited to come here, I think we should be able to have the right to say to the new commission, advisory commission, problems that have occurred, things that need to be looked at very carefully. How are they going to know that?
No, I agree with you. I'm not saying that there's total discussion and bringing up all the information, but I think that's one thing, and then the roundtable is another whole thing.
But that won't be with Maura Healy.
Correct.
Let's leave that
open. I would suggest some combination of Maura coming for a period of time, but my sense is she would be coming also to listen. She would have some things to say.
Exactly, yeah.
And she would also be here to listen, and there would be other, certainly staff with the Attorney General would be here. So, I mean, part of this question is how to provide an ongoing process through some series of sessions that moves the capacity for municipal compliance forward, working through the commissions and the coordinators.
Exactly.
Yeah, and I would hope, and I guess we would find this out when we know more about what the advisory commission is going to be doing, that they would be a conduit for getting ADA coordinators and commissions together and on the same page and getting information out. Again, I don't really know what else is happening with this advisory, but I would see that being a focal point for all of us to look at beyond Massachusetts Office on Disability.
Yeah, another change is the Office on Disability has had a very important role in for community access monitor. Commission's leadership there, a new director at some point, perhaps whether we're deep into the winter or beyond, to also see if we can get the new director to get out here to Western Mass. Yeah. It can feel like an awfully long distance from here to Boston, as we all know.
Mm-hmm. It is quite the trip. And back when the Voting Rights Act, and we had to purchase equipment specialized for persons with disabilities, that monies were funded through the Secretary of State's office and purchased for communities. It would be great if something similar to that through some other agency, which of course would be monies coming determined by the legislature, to help fund what we all need in communities and our municipalities for, you know, equipment that's in not just equipment, but some kind of funding that can help really bring your community up to grade.
All right, so question. Chris, you're gonna check it out with Maura Healy's office. If we could get her in here in October.
I will see if we can.
Can you do that and get
but the earliest point from when Judy and I did that from our travels.
That's what I mean.
When we can get more.
Because you're coming back in the middle part of October, correct? Because we could still have our Commission on Disabilities meeting for October 20th. Okay, don't know if you're back or not.
Yeah.
We will be back.
Okay. We can still have that meeting, but I think with Maura Healy, because she's in Boston and that a lot.
She travels.
Yes, she travels a lot. I don't even care if it's a Friday or a Saturday or whatever. We need to accommodate her. We need to accommodate her, and we need to accommodate the advisory committee.
I will ask for a date that they can project when we could then invite commissions and coordinators to speak to this moving municipal.
Do you think there's a possibility that you get several dates?
I don't know.
Why would we need several dates?
Well, because if Moore can be here on a Tuesday, I have to say the great room's not available, so we wouldn't be able to use
well, that. We would find, if Moore is here, we will find a location. Whether it's here, I wouldn't worry about the room. We will find a location to host the Attorney General.
Right, I know the mayor will.
I guarantee. But I think there are great constraints on her schedule,
I imagine.
So we would. Yeah.
What meetings do you have here on Tuesdays, Patty? You have a group, right?
The Hampshire Coral Society. The
room gets set. You can just let Maura know that Tuesdays is bad here at the Senior Center. That would be helpful.
We'll look for it.
Yeah.
And so we'd love to have the Senior Center if that worked out.
We'd love to, absolutely.
Yes. But that room is huge. And it's available for the city for us to have it.
Yep.
It's a good room. We also have a kitchen in there where we can bring drinks and stuff like that, like coffee and everything. You know, and if she has to stay overnight, you know for a fact we'll find her a place very easily.
A question, when we have a meeting like that, would we also, I would assume some other city officials and potentially some legislators would like to be here.
No, definitely.
I think some of the legislators who would be very good to have them
yes.
here. Some of the funding needs.
Yes, I think also our district attorney, Dave Sullivan.
I'm just thinking that you'll be members. Yeah. DA Sullivan will definitely make that if you have.
I know for a fact being on the committee, on the advisory committee for civil rights.
Yeah, no, he won't make
really it. Really big into that.
The gregarious, Mr. Sullivan.
Yes, and I can get a hold of Peter Kopat. He's on my ward.
Senator
Rosenberg, we could get you to give his office a call, if not my turn. Right? I mean, all your reps will come.
Right, and Bill Newman, some old liberties.
Yes, definitely.
The reps will come, but we will make it clear that the focus is commissions and coordinators that they're
exactly.
here.
Exactly. And it's for the public, too.
They're yes.
It's only for the public. So Patty, did you hear what he was saying?
No.
No, we'll sort that. We can sort it.
Okay.
Yeah, can you come up with a list?
Yeah, he's going to talk to Maura Gillen. We're
and
talking
could,
about
and
reps and so forth.
With the chair, the vice chair, you as the coordinator, and Marion.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Got it.
Yep.
Chris. Okay. Ian has asked me to take over the meeting, unless there's another member that would like to do that.
Certainly.
Thank you, Hannah.
Thank you, Tori.
I mean,
Tori. He's having a good day.
Tori
Hill. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you for doing a good job.
Oh, thank you. Have a good rest of the meeting, and I'll talk to you all soon.
Okay.
Bye.
So we're going to be looking at October, Pat. Mm-hmm. And you know, Chris, I think what I'll also do is to go in and see the mayor and talk with him and give him a heads up so that we make sure once we know the date, she's given accommodations.
And I could stop him.
Yes, that would be great.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Super.
So revision of the commission's policy and deadline for agenda items to be submitted. So the committee had determined that Tuesday's items were to be submitted for the agenda, but that's up for discussion.
Okay, no matter what, okay. We said that you could go ahead and have your agenda sent in Tuesday before the meetings. That is not what it says with the charter. So you have 48 hours. If you want to do a revision, say you had something you wanted to talk about, you could notify, after that Tuesday, we stated, you have 48 hours, okay, that it has to be posted. That's the law. When you printed it out for me, because anybody can do a revision.
So from now on, the meeting agenda won't get posted until 48 hours before.
Yes.
So it gives everybody the opportunity to get items on.
We didn't realize it, Pam.
Yeah, so that's all taken care of. Jim, are you wanting to do your presentation now, or would you like to wait till September?
Yeah, let's do it next time.
Next time.
I apologize, it was in training all day in Springfield today. The only day that they did it was today, so we'll put on for next time.
Okay, so, yeah, I get to already know that, so.
Patty, can we just clear something because of my hearing right now? I want to get this straightened out. Chris is going to handle more yearly. He will notify me and you on dates that she's accessible. He also just told me he will talk to the mayor, which is great.
Well, I'm just, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's good.
Yes. Yeah, and I will also notify the chair and vice chair, right? That would be the appropriate board.
Yes.
Well, you know.
How is it generally done? Do you disseminate communication or?
Tori, a lot of the business of the commission, Tori gets it out. She'll do the agenda, get the minutes out, and we all kind of email if something comes up, you know, that we think everybody should know. So if you're going to notify, it would be Tori, definitely, probably Mary Ann and myself, and then whoever we need to then get it out further.
Especially something as big as this.
Very good. And I also hope I haven't, we will certainly try to get it locked in at that age, but more of an understanding that our schedule is often demanded.
Yes, I can imagine. Any other business that anybody would like to bring up?
I just quickly would like to introduce Chris. I know things because we had Hannah, who's the co-chair, okay, and Tori not here. Just give a little history about yourself to the commission, please.
Oh, okay. I'm Chris Palamas. Judy and I live over on Park Hill Road. We moved into Northampton at the end of 2001. Judy was born in the valley, and I was in Newport in 1970. I started Stavros in 1972, although I have no relationship with that organization. Now, I worked at the Mass Office on Disability from 1984 to 88, when there was money in the state budget, and a guy by the name of Mike Dukakis was our governor. Since then, I created a very small nonprofit, Independent Living Resources. I run from home, and we do all kinds of stuff, which included national ADA training and local. I do a lot of work now for the Division of Capital Asset Management and Maintenance under an initiative that started with Maura Ely 6 years ago, when we rather aggressively pointed out some of the things that had lapsed on state ADA compliance. So I've done a lot of this stuff, and this is my this is my home community, so it's a pleasure to join you all.
Well, welcome.
I don't know nearly as much as I pretend to, but you know, we try to fill in the blanks as we go. But I have done a lot on ADA.
Okay. Is there a motion to adjourn?
There
is no August meeting, and so we'll see you in September, as the song goes.
Great.